name's MJ with MinIO, and in this video, we're going to go through the labs for the installing MinIO using Docker on a single node, single drive environment. So let's jump into this. The first thing we're going to want to do is to pull down the images, and so we'll use Docker pull for that. So we will pull the latest image, and we will pull that down to our local system here. And we will also pull down a older release just so you can see the differences in how these run. And now we've pulled down the one from 2.22. If we do that, we do Docker image ls, we can see that we have both those releases here locally. This you might want to do if you are concerned about your internet connection speed and you don't want these to take a long time to spin up when you're running these. You can pre-pull these images, but they will also automatically pull when you run the Docker commands. So you don't have to do this step, but it is recommended that you do. Next, we need to create a place on the local file system where MinIO will store its data. So we're actually going to create two directories here because we're going to create two containers. So the first one we're going to do is mount data and MinIO. And then the next one is going to be mount data MinIO specific release. And you'll see why in just a short time here. So now we've got a couple of things. We've got the container images downloaded to the local system, and we've got a place for MinIO to store data. The next thing we need to do is configure a configuration file or create a configuration file for these containers to actually work with. So we're gonna use the nano tool, VI or Vim lovers, don't get mad at me here, but we'll go ahead and use nano to do that. And again, in the links below the video, we will leave documentation and links to where you can go and get these files yourself and then modify them and work with them. But in this case, I'm just going to use the one from the earlier slides, and this will be found on the MinIO website as well. But in this case, we are simply defining the root user and root password, as well as the location inside the container where the external data source that we just created will be mounted inside the container. So in this case, we're going to use MinIO admin. Don't do that. This is just for demonstration purposes. And then feel free to leave this mapped to mount data inside the container. That'll just make it easier. So we'll go ahead and save that file and get out of there. And now we can get to actually running this because we have all the components we need to actually run this. So this first one will actually go ahead and run the latest version of the container. So you'll see Docker run minus dt. So minus d is detached and t is a tty session. So you get a nice interface if you ever drop into this container. Next, we will map 9000 and 9000. So 9000 on the host, 9000 inside the container, and 9090 on the host to 9090 inside the container. We're mapping the mount data MinIO directory that we just created to the location inside the container for mount data. We will also map that configuration file that we've created at etc default MinIO to the etc config.n file inside there. And we're gonna pass an environmental variable command, MinIO config end file, just inside the container to let MinIO know where to look for that file. And in this case, we've named it etc config.n. So that's where we wanna point it. We're gonna give this container a name of MinIO, and then we're calling the MinIO latest container image that we just pulled down. And the command we're running is server console address 9090. Now you're gonna see why it's important to pay attention here, because even if we run externally a different port inside the container, this is informing the container what port to actually run inside the container, not outside the container. So you'll see that change here shortly. So it actually said it couldn't find latest, but it did download it. That was odd. But let's go ahead and check to see if it's even running. So we're gonna run Docker logs MinIO. And you can see here that's giving me a warning about these default credentials. It doesn't like those. But this is what we talked about earlier, is that this is saying that we can get to this using this 172.17.0.2. That's actually a container's IP address. So we will not be able to reach it with that. We're gonna have to find the host IP address to actually reach this. It also gives you a warning here that there is only a single drive mapped because we're running single node, single drive. So again, this is really for development purposes, and you need to pay attention to how you're using this. Do not use it in this way in production. Before we actually jump into accessing this, we're actually going to run another version of this container. And so in this case, we're actually going to run the same thing, except with an older version of the MinIO. In this case, it's release 2023.02.22. And also note that because we've already used port 9000 and 9090 on the host, we actually have to choose different host ports, otherwise it will conflict and cause a failure. So in this case, we've chosen 9001 for the API port and 9091 for the console port. But note that the console address is still 9090. That's because we're not defining the console address on the host, but rather we're telling the container where to listen, what port to listen on to run the console. So because we're still mapping to 9090 inside the container from 9091, then we need to tell MinIO inside the container to come up on port 9090 for this to work. So we'll go ahead and run that. And if we run docker ps, we can see that there are now two containers running, both running a different version of MinIO. And if we do docker logs MinIO, what did I call this? Specific release. Helps if I could spell. You'll see that this is also up and running, gives you all the same warnings, but also warns you that this is an older version that was released 2 weeks ago. So this is just some nice additional information that you will pay attention to there. So now that we've done that, we can actually do a couple things. The first thing we're gonna do is actually go access this in a web UI. So you can see here that I've gone to 9090, which would be the MinIO container, but I've also mapped to 9091, which is the other container, and we'll actually be able to see that here soon. So if I go MinIO admin, and log in here, you can see that we are in here. And if I run this and say MinIO test bucket one and create that bucket, you can see that that is now created here, and we would be able to upload something to this bucket. So let's go ahead and just upload something real quick. We'll just upload a small file here. And we can see now that there is a file uploaded to that one. Now, if I come over here to this other one, because remember we mapped this not only to a different port, but also to a different backend storage, even though it's on the same system, then we should not see that newly created bucket in this information here. So as we log into this one, this is a completely separate instance using a different backend storage. I'll actually show that to you here in a minute. But this one, we will call it MinIO test bucket two. We'll go ahead and create that bucket and upload something to that bucket as well. Let's choose a different file in this case. We'll choose the 50 meg file, and that uploaded rather quickly. And so now if we hop back over to the host and we do a tree on mount data, we can see that now there are two separate storage locations on a single drive because we're running two separate instances of MinIO, two separate Docker instances of it. This is treated completely separately because we've also defined different backend storage, even though it's on the same drive. And so you could actually have multiple instances running, but you still run into that same issue where if you do not have some sort of parity or protection, high availability on the system, then if you lose this drive, then you've lost all your data for all of your instances. But I just wanted to show that it is possible to run multiple instances side by side on a single host if you want to do some testing to see how they each acted with your particular, let's say you're doing some development or something like that, or you're doing some testing on newer features. So you can see here that this one has test bucket one and this one has test bucket two, and it has its respective 10 meg file in this one and 50 meg file in the other one. What you can also do here is to actually connect to this using the MinIO client. So we're gonna run an mc alias command. So we're gonna say mc alias set, we're gonna call this one MinIO, and we're connecting to the external, not what it gave you in the logs, but the external IP of this host on the port that we defined externally using the username and password in the configuration file. And you can see here that it successfully added that. And now we can also go ahead and add the other one as well. In this case, we're saying that this should be called MinIO specific release, and we're addressing it on port 9001. And again, it is now added that successfully. So now if we do mc admin info MinIO, we can see that this has been up and running for 5 minutes. We can see what version it is. In this case, it's 313, and that there is a single drive pool, and one drive is okay. And 10 megs are used because that's the size of the file that we uploaded here. And we can also run the same thing against the MinIO specific release and see that this one is actually running the pinned version that we gave it, the 2.22.23 version, And it also has one drive, but this one's using 50 megs because we uploaded a 50 meg file here. So that's pretty straightforward, and that should really get you up and going and be able to successfully start using this for a development environment or testing or whatever you need this for. But again, this is not production grade, so make sure you're taking that into account when you're building this out, but it will be really good for local development or testing of certain features or upgrade testing to make sure that the newer version maybe that you're moving to still has the functionality that you need in there. Sometimes features are deprecated and sometimes features are added. So it all depends on your use cases, but hopefully you've learned something from these couple of videos, and we thank you for watching. In the next series of videos, we will actually show how to run all of this using Docker Compose. So make sure you stay tuned for that. Thanks for watching. Have a good one.